Symbolism is something which is very central in all Romantic thought, that has always been noticed by all critics of this movement. Now, let me try and make this as clear as I'm able, although I don't claim to understand it entirely. I don't claim to understand it entirely because, as Schelling very rightly says, what Romanticism truly is a wild wood, a labyrinth, in which the only guiding thread is the will and the mood of a poet. As I'm no poet, I cannot altogether trust myself to give you a full exposition of this particular doctrine, but I shall do my best. There are two kinds of symbols, to put it its very simplest. There are conventional symbols and symbols of a somewhat different kind. Conventional symbols offer no difficulty. They are symbols which we invent for the purpose of meaning certain things, and there are rules about what they mean. The red and green traffic lights mean what they mean by convention. Red lights means that motor cars may not pass, and they are simply another form of saying, do not pass. Do not pass is itself a form of symbolism, linguistic symbolism, which itself stands for some kind of ban on the part of persons in authority and holds within it some kind of threat, a perfectly understood threat, that if you disobey this particular order, dire consequences may follow. Now, this is ordinary symbolism, such as it is in, for example, artificially invented languages, scientific treatises, and any kind of conventional symbolism invented for a specific purpose where the meaning of the symbol is laid down by rule. But there obviously are symbols not quite of this kind. I don't wish to enter into the theory of symbolism in general, but for my particular purpose, what these people meant by symbolism was symbolism for something which could only be expressed symbolically and could not be expressed literally. The traffic situation is such that if instead of the green and red light you were to put up signs saying stop or go, or if instead of that you even placed persons of obvious authority to cry through megaphones stop and go, this would serve its purpose in a certain sense equally well, at least so far as grammatical purposes are concerned. Now, if you ask, for example, in what sense a national flag waving in the wind which arouses emotions in people's breasts is a symbol, or in what sense the Marseillaise is a symbol, or to go a little further, in what sense, for example, say a cathedral is part of its function as a building in which religious rites occur, or in which religious services occur, in what sense a Gothic cathedral built in a particular way is a symbol for some kind of, for the particular religion which it houses, or in what sense sacred dances are symbols, or in what sense any kind of religious ritual is a symbol, whatever it may be, or in what sense the Kaaba stone is a great symbol to the Muslims. The answer will be that what it symbolizes is literally not expressible in any other way. If you say, would you spell out for me what it is that the word England stands for in the sentence, England expects every man to do his duty, let us say, when Nelson said it. And then you begin to spell out, you say England means a certain number of persons, a certain number of featherless bipeds with reason, inhabiting a certain island at a particular moment in the early 19th century. Well, it clearly doesn't mean that. It doesn't mean any particular, it doesn't simply mean a group of persons with names and addresses known to Nelson, whom in some sort of way he could, if he wished and took enough trouble, spell out. It plainly doesn't mean that because the whole emotive force of the word England extends over something both vaguer and profounder. And if you say, what exactly is it that the word England stands for here, would you, so to speak, unpack it? Would you unpack it? Would you give me, however tedious it may be, the literal equivalent of what this is simply a shorthand for? This will not be easy to do. Nor will it be very easy if you say, what is it that the Kaaba stone stands for? What is it that this particular sacred, this prayer stands for? What is it that this cathedral means to the people who come to worship in it, apart from associations of a vaguely emotional kind, apart from a penumbra? It isn't simply that it arouses emotion. Emotion might be aroused by the singing of birds. Emotion might be aroused by a sunset, but a sunset is not a symbol, and the singing of birds is not symbolic. But a cathedral is a symbol, a religious rite is a symbol, the raising of the host is a symbol to worshippers. And the question now arises, what is it symbolic of? Now, the whole of the Romantic doctrine maintained that there is an infinite striving forward on the part of reality, the universe around us. That there is something which is infinite, something which is in some sense inexhaustible, of which the finite attempts to be the symbol, but of course cannot be. You seek to convey something which you can only convey by such means as you have at your command, but you know that this cannot convey the whole of what you are seeking to convey because this whole is literally infinite. That is why allegories are used. That is why symbols are used. An allegory is a representation in words or in paint of something which has its own meaning but also stands for something other than itself. When an allegory stands for something other than itself, that which it stands for those who really believe in allegories and who say that the only mode of profound speech is allegorical, as Schelling believed, as the Romantics in general believed, what the allegory stands for is ex hypothesi, not statable itself. And that is why the allegory has to be used. And that is why allegories and symbols are of necessity the only mode which I have of conveying that which I wish to convey. Now, what is it that I wish to convey? I wish to convey, of course, this stream of which Fichte speaks. I wish to convey something immaterial, and I have to use material means for it. I have to convey something which is inexpressible, and I have to use expression. I have to convey perhaps something unconscious, and I have to use conscious means. And I know in advance that it won't succeed and cannot succeed, and therefore all I can do is to get nearer and nearer in some asymptotic approach. I do my best, but it is an agonizing struggle in which, if I'm an artist, or indeed any kind of self-conscious thinker for the German Romantics, I'm engaged in the whole of my life. In a certain sense, this is something to do with the notion of depth. The notion of depth is something with which philosophers seldom deal. Nevertheless, it is a concept perfectly susceptible to treatment, and indeed one of the most important of the categories that we use. When we say that a work is profound or deep, quite apart from the fact that this is obviously a metaphor, I suppose, from wells, which are profound and deep, when one says that someone is a profound writer or a profound picture or a work of music is profound, it's not very clear what we mean, but we certainly do not wish to exchange it for some other word, such as beautiful or important or constructed according to rules or even immortal. When I say that Pascal is profounder than Descartes, although Descartes, no doubt, was a man of genius, or that Dostoevsky, whom I may or may not like, is a profounder writer than Tolstoy, whom I may like much better, or any of these things, so to speak, if I say that Kafka is a profounder writer than Hemingway, or something of that kind, if I say that, what exactly am I trying unsuccessfully, in a sense, to convey by means of this metaphor, which remains metaphorical because I have nothing better that I can use? According to the Romantics, and I think this is one of the principal contributions to understanding in general, according to the Romantics, what I mean by depth, although they don't discuss it under that name, is inexhaustibility, unembraceability. In the cases of what might be called beautiful but not profound, say works of art or even pieces of prose fiction or philosophy, I can translate into perfectly lucid, literal terms. I can explain to you, say, about some musical work of the 18th century, well-constructed, melodious, agreeable, even perhaps a work of genius, why it is made and even why it gives pleasure. I can tell you that certain kinds of harmonies are the kinds of things which human beings feel a particular kind of pleasure in listening to. I can describe this pleasure perhaps quite minutely by all kinds of ingenious introspective devices. If I am a marvelous describer, if I am Proust, if I am Tolstoy, if I am a well-trained descriptive psychologist, I might succeed in giving you some kind of version of your actual emotions when listening to a particular piece of music, or reading a particular piece of prose, which is sufficiently similar to what in fact you are feeling or thinking at this particular moment, to be regarded as an adequate prose translation of what is occurring, scientific, true, objective, verifiable, and so on. In the case of works which are profound, the more I say, the more remains to be said. There is no doubt that, although I attempt to describe it, it's quite clear, as soon as I speak, it becomes quite clear that no matter how long I speak, new chasms open. No matter what I say, I always have to leave three dots at the end. Whatever description I give always opens the doors to something further, something even darker perhaps, but certainly something which in principle is incapable of being reduced to precise, clear, verifiable, objective prose. And that being so, this I think is certainly one of the meanings of what is meant by profound. The notion of irreducibility, the notion that I am forced in discussing it, forced in describing it to use language which is in principle, not only today but forever, inadequate for its purpose. I do my best, but I know that it cannot be exhausted. And the more inexhaustible it seems to me to be, and the wider the region to which it seems to me to apply, the more chasms open, the deeper the chasms and the larger the number of them, put it very crudely, the wider the area of which they open, the more liable I am to say that this particular proposition is profound and not merely true or interesting or amusing or original or whatever else I might be tempted to say. When, for example, someone like Pascal says in the famous remark that the heart has its reason as well as the head, when Goethe says, no matter how hard we try, there will always be an irreducible element of anthropomorphism in everything we do and think, these remarks have struck people as profound for this reason, because wherever they apply them, they open new vistas. And these vistas are not reducible, not embraceable, not describable, not collectible, not, as it were, you have no formula which will, by deduction, lead you to all of them. This, I think, is really the fundamental notion of depth in the Romantics, and this is what all this, not all, but most of this talk about the finite standing for the infinite, the material standing for the immaterial, the dead standing for the living, space standing for time, word standing for something which is itself wordless, this is what to a large degree it relates to. This is certainly, can the sacred be seized? Asked Friedrich Schlegel. And he replied, no, it can never be seized because the mere imposition of form deforms it. And this is fundamentally what I think runs through the entire theory of life and of art. What this leads to, in a certain sense, are two quite interesting and obsessive phenomena, which then are really very present both in 19th and in 20th century thought and feeling. One is nostalgia and the other is paranoia of a certain kind. Nostalgia, the nostalgia is due to the fact that since the infinite cannot be exhausted, and since we are seeking, in some sense, to embrace it, nothing that we do will ever satisfy us. When Novalis was asked where he thought he was tending, what his art was in some sense about, he said, I'm always going home, always to my father's house, which was in a sense a religious remark. But what of course he meant was that all these attempts at the exotic, the strange, the foreign, the odd, all these attempts to emerge from the empirical framework of daily life, of writing fantastic stories with transformations and transmogrifications of the most peculiar kind, attempts at writing down stories which are symbolic or allegorical or contain all kinds of mystical and veiled references, esoteric imagery of the most peculiar kind which has preoccupied critics for years. These things are all attempts to go back, to go home to what is pulling and drawing him, this famous infinite Sehnsucht of the Romantics, this search for the blue flower, as Novalis called it. The search for the blue flower is an attempt to dissolve myself in the infinite, in some sense, either to absorb it into myself, somehow or other to make myself at one with it, either to absorb it into myself or to dissolve myself into it. This is a secularized version, obviously, of that profound religious striving of being at one with God, of reviving the Christ within me, of making myself one with some of the creative forces of nature in some pagan sense, which comes to the Germans from Plato, from Eckhart, from Böhme, from German mysticism, from a number of other sources, except that here it takes a literary and a secular form. And this particular nostalgia is the very opposite of what the Enlightenment regarded as its particular contribution. The Enlightenment supposed that there was a closed, perfect pattern of life, as I tried to explain. There was some kind of form of life and of art and of feeling and of thought which was correct, which was right, which was true and objective and could be taught to people if only we knew enough. There was some kind of solution to our problems. And if only we could construct a structure which according to the solution and then proceed to fit ourselves, as it were, to put it crudely, into the structure, we would obtain answers both to problems of thought and to problems of action. But if this is not so, if hypothesis, the universe is a movement and not at rest, if it is a form of activity and not, so to speak, a lump of stuff, if it is infinite and not finite, if it is constantly varying and never still and never the same, to use these various metaphors which they constantly use, if it is a constant wave, says Schlegel, how can we possibly, even in trying to describe it, what are we to do when we describe a wave? We usually end up by producing a stagnant pool. When we try and describe the light, we can only describe it accurately by putting it out. Therefore, don't let's attempt to describe it, but of course you can't not attempt to describe it, because that means to stop expressing, but to stop expressing is to stop living. For these Romantics, to live is to do something. To do is to express your nature. To express your nature is to express your relation to the universe. Your relation to the universe is inexpressible, which you must nevertheless express. And this is the agony, this is the problem, this is the unending Sehnsucht, this is the yearning, this is the reason why we must go to distant countries, that is why we seek for exotic examples, that is why we travel in the East, that is why we write novels about the past, that is why we indulge in fantasies, and so on and so on. That, I think, is the typical Romantic nostalgia. If the home for which they are seeking, if the harmony, the perfection about which they talk, could be granted to them, they would reject it. It's very much because it is in principle something which they know, which is by definition something to which an approach can be made which cannot be seized, because that is the nature of reality. It reminds one of that famous cynical story about someone who said to Dante Gabriel Rossetti when he was writing about the Holy Grail, but Mr. Rossetti, when you have found the Grail, what will you do with it? Well, this is precisely the typical questions which the Romantics knew very well how to answer. In their case, the Grail was in principle both undiscoverable and such that one could not avoid, could not stop, one's whole life could not be prevented from being a perpetual search for it. And that is because of the nature of the universe such as it is. It might have been different, but it isn't. The brute fact about the universe is that it isn't fully expressible, it isn't fully exhaustible, it isn't at rest, it is at motion, and this, so to speak, is the basic datum. And that is what we discover when we discover that the self is something of which we are only aware in effort. Effort is action, action is movement, movement is unfinishable, so to speak, a perpetual movement. That, I think, is the fundamental romantic image which I'm trying to convey as best I can in words which ex hypothesi cannot convey it. Now, the second notion, which is that of paranoia, is something somewhat different. There is an optimistic version, of course, in romanticism. What the romantics feel is that by going forward, by expanding our nature, by destroying the obstacles in our path, whatever they may be, dead French rules of the 18th century, political and economic institutions of a destructive kind, laws, authority, any kind of cut-and-dried truth, any kind of either rules or institutions which in some way are regarded as absolute, perfect, unappealable from, in doing this, we are liberating ourselves more and more and allowing our infinite nature to soar to greater and greater heights and become wider, deeper, freer, more vital, more like the divinity towards which it strives. But there is another version of the same thing, a more pessimistic version, which I think is, curiously enough, something which really obsesses the 20th century to some extent. There is the notion that although we, individuals, seek to liberate ourselves, yet the universe is not to be tamed in this easy fashion. There is something behind, there is something in the dark depths of the unconscious, or there is something in the dark depths of history, or there is something at any rate not seized by us which in some way frustrates our dearest wishes. Sometimes it's conceived as a kind of indifferent or even hostile nature. Sometimes it is conceived as the cunning of history which optimists think bear us ever towards more and more glorious goals, but pessimists think is simply, like Schopenhauer, for example, think that is simply a huge, fathomless ocean of undirected will upon which we bob like a little boat with no direction and no possibility of really either understanding the element in which we are or directing our course upon it. And this is a huge, powerful, ultimately hostile force to resist which, or even to come to terms with which, is never of the slightest use. It takes all kinds of other forms. It takes much cruder forms. It takes the form of looking for all kinds of conspiracies in history, for example. People begin to think perhaps history is formed by forces over which we have no control. Someone is at the back of it all. Perhaps the Jesuits, perhaps the Jews, perhaps the Freemasons. This, of course, was much stimulated by attempts to explain the course of the French Revolution. We, and the enlightened, we, the virtuous, we, the wise, we, the good and the kind, seek to do this or that. But somehow all our efforts end in nothing. And therefore there must be some fearful hostile force which is, as it were, lying in wait for us and trips us up when we're on the brink, as we think, of great success. This takes, as I say, crude forms such as a conspiracy view of history by which we always look for concealed enemies, sometimes for a larger conception such as, say, economic forces, the forces of production in Marx, or class war in Marx, or a much vaguer and more metaphysical notion of the cunning of reason or of history in Hegel, which understands its goal much better than we do and plays tricks upon us. Hegel says, the spirit cheats us, the spirit intrigues, the spirit lies, the spirit triumphs. He almost conceives of it as a kind of huge, ironical, Aristophanic sort of force, which mocks the poor human beings who are trying to construct their little homes upon the slopes of what they regard as a green and flowery mountain, but which turns out to be the vast volcano of human history, which is about to erupt once again, ultimately perhaps for human good, ultimately in order to realize itself towards an ideal, but in the short run, destroying a large number of innocent persons and causing a very great deal of suffering and of damage. This also is a romantic idea, because once you get the notion that there is outside us something larger, something unseizable, something unattainable, you either have feelings towards it of love, as Fichte wanted, or of fear. And if you have feelings of fear, it becomes paranoid. And this paranoia then goes on accumulating in the 19th century. It accumulates to height in Schopenhauer. It dominates the works of Wagner. And it comes to an immense climax in all kinds of works in the 20th century, which obsessed by the thought of the fact that somehow, no matter what we do, there is some canker, there's a worm in the bud somewhere, there is something which dooms us to perpetual frustration, whether it be human beings whom we must exterminate, or impersonal forces against which all effort is useless. Certainly, works by writers like Kafka, for example, are filled with this peculiar sense of undirected angst, of terror, of basic apprehension, which isn't fixated upon any identifiable object. And this is very true about the early Romantic works as well. If you read Tieck's stories, Der Blonde Eckbert, for example, terror pervades it. No doubt it's meant to be an allegory. But what always happens is that the hero begins by living happily, and then something terrible happens. A golden bird appears before him, sings a song about Waldeinsamkeit, which is already a romantic concept about solitude in the woods of a half delightful and half terrifying sort. And then he kills the bird, and then various misfortunes follow, and he goes on killing, he goes on destroying, he gets enmeshed in a frightful net which some awful mysterious force has laid for him. He seeks to liberate himself from it, he murders more, he struggles, he fights, he goes under. This kind of nightmare is extremely typical of early German romantic writing. And it comes from exactly the same source, which is this notion of the will as dominating life, not reason, not an order of things which can be studied and therefore controlled, but of some kind of will. So long as it is my will and a will directed towards ends which I myself manufacture, it is presumably benevolent. So long as it is the will of a benevolent deity or the will of a history which is guaranteed to bring me to a happy conclusion, as it is in all the optimistic writings of all the optimistic historical philosophers, that presumably is not too terrifying. But it may turn out that the end is much blacker and more terrifying and more unfathomable than I think. And so the Romantics tend, on the whole, to oscillate between extremes of mystical optimism and appalling pessimism. And this gives our writings a peculiar kind of uneven quality.